Special touch with every note he played, he made us see the colors in his mind in shades of blue and green. He'd paint the autumn leaves with chords that made them shine. And when he played time, remembered time became suspended. He could change the coldest winter day to turn out all the stars. Oh, how his heart could sing. His song will live forever, even though his voice is still always I remember. became suspended, he could change the coldest winter day to very early spring. And when he touched the keys, he'd turn out all the stars. His heart could sing, his song will live forever, even though his voice is still I hear the music, feel the magic. I remember Bill.
Thank you. Thank you. it's on my window, sweet, the sound rain can make. Nice to lie here, softly sighing. Thank you.
sadness brings deeper hues of colors, shades I never thought could ever exist, colors that dream like blue and green. They seem deeper than blasé thoughts from the conscious mind, or an easy smile from a lonely heart. And I remember the time when we were close as blue in green.
The thing that occurs to me is that I wasn't striving to be an identifiable stylist. I was really only striving to make music and to put it together in some way of my own. And as I say, I'm a very analytical person, and I did sort of block by block build this thing, which eventually works by itself. And as far as the harmony is concerned, I suppose I've just torn it apart and tried to get fundamental and understand it and work with it and draw from various areas of music and sound and came up with this kind of thing. But I think the thing that, now, you know, it always used to surprise me that people said I had an identity, that they could recognize me, because it wasn't the thing that I strived for. And I think it might be good for somebody to realize that ultimately, you are an individual. If you dedicate yourself to building something and putting it together, your individuality comes through, and it doesn't have affectation, which is one of the reasons that I didn't follow these other paths. Remember when I was talking about, you know, going into other areas like, you know, avant-garde or whatever, you know, because that would have become, in some ways, partially an affectation. And I think what you must do is, you know, stay with your identity, build your own thing. Then your identity comes through in a very real way, which is proven, because really I wasn't, you know, pointing for that at all. So it's interesting. I think one of the reasons that maybe a lot of younger pianists, developing pianists, look to me is because I have put my music together so carefully and with such logic and analytical intelligence that they can benefit from it in that way and use it and perhaps depart from it eventually and whatever. And they can learn from it more positively because they can see the logic and see the reasons for almost everything I do. And as far as where it all comes from. It comes from everywhere, and I only put it together from my own experience and what was happening at the time and in context and according to my own feeling for integrity and so forth, you know, and expressiveness. So as far as that goes, it's difficult to explain. But that's very gratifying, and I think it's interesting from that standpoint of identity. And I remember reading a letter from Mozart to his father where he said almost the same thing about style, you know, and he said, you know, the individuality or the recognizability of my music is no more conscious than the nose on my face. There is the feeling that I have that, you know, art often precedes social change, and I look to jazz as an honest and pure art. Hopefully it is the one of the few, if only, areas of music which has crossed over racial, geographical boundaries and spiritual boundary, every kind of boundary. It is an amalgamation of the best, and when the chips are down, it's the honesty that is the mover, as, like I said, when Miles called me, you know, whatever. And I think, hopefully, that jazz won't be stifled by the tremendous commercial forces. I don't believe it will. I've always felt that it exists because it just naturally attracts the best talents, and it has a life of its own. However, we hopefully would have more exposure to it, and perhaps it can help lead, you know, the world to greater love and understanding. And however, at the same time, it does worry me a bit that the forces of commercialism and the catering to the lowest common denominator have become such a way of life and intimidate even discriminating people into attributing qualities and to the music and to the work that, you know, that it doesn't necessarily have. And it does worry me a bit that, you know, it's such a monstrous, powerful thing. And all I could think is that if this portends the future, we're just going to all end up looking and being the same, because what we're doing is catering to the greatest common denominator, which is sameness at the end. I mean, it can only work toward that kind of a result. So we have these two kind of forces. And I remember looking at China as it developed out of, you know, its new political system, and worrying that art and culture and creative work had practically no place. And happily now, it seems that their attitude is taking a complete about face, and they're just hungry for, and the people have to be very hungry to be creative and, you know, to become part of the mainstream of the better cultural streams of, you know, of the world. And they are. They're still, you know, don't have a lot of conservatories and art schools and everything, but they are hungry for it, and I think it's going to develop. Otherwise, it kind of worried me, you know. It kind of worried me that bread and butter, which are fundamentally important, should completely sweep aside the finer things and the aesthetic side of life.